Hello and welcome to the episode 100 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Unfortunately, this will not be a happy or celebrative episode. Among the highlights, we have a tragic and sudden death, the Beatles' last appearance on Top of the Pops, and, well, the announcement of the band's breakup. On the 10th of April 1961, the Beatles' residency at the Top 10 Club in Hamburg, West Germany, continued with another concert for the band, still featuring Pete Best on drums. Exactly 1 year later, in 1962, Stuart Stu Sutcliffe died of brain hemorrhage. He was 21. Painter, former bass player of the Beatles, he was even instrumental in finding the band's name, he was one of John Lennon's closest friends. He had recently suffered from headaches and blackouts, but he had believed that these were a result of overworking. After collapsing during an art school class in his college in Hamburg, Stuart underwent medical examination on insistence of Astrid Kircher, his girlfriend, and her family. They feared that Sutcliffe might have had a brain tumor, but several exams and visits to the doctor later, everything turned out to be negative, and Sutcliffe was still none the wiser about his problems. During March 1962, his health had further deteriorated, and Stuart was forced to spend the last 2 weeks of his life in bed. The headaches, the fits to the head, episodes of temporary blindness, and the wild mood swings ended today, when Sutcliffe collapsed for the last time. He was rushed to the hospital, but he was dead before the arrival. The probable cause of death was an aneurysm or a malformation of a vein in the brain, arteriovenous malformation for the clinically minded. The theories according to which the problem had been caused by a fistfight gone wrong many months before, someone claimed that it had involved John Lennon, for example, are utter nonsense, as they do not agree with the testimony about Sutcliffe's worsening condition in the last weeks of his life. In 1963, the Beatles performed for the last time at the Majestic Ballroom in Birkenhead. They had played 17 times at the venue, starting on the 28th of June 1962. In 1964, the Fabs were at the Twickenham Film Studios to continue the shooting for their first feature film, A Hard Day's Night, with a production office sequence. On the 10th of April 1965, the Beatles were at the Studio 2 of the Riverside Studios in London to record what will turn out to be their last appearance on Top of the Pops, BBC's biggest pop music programme. Starting from 1:30 p.m., the band rehearsed and then filmed their mimed performances of Ticket to Ride and Yes It Is. The Fabs were wearing, for the first time in public, the cream-colored jackets that will become known as the Shea Stadium Jackets. Today's day performance of the Beatles would be aired on the 15th of April. Fun fact for all the Doctor Who lovers out there, a 25-second snippet of the Ticket to Ride mime performance was also shown on The Executioner, the first episode of a 6-part Doctor Who show narrative arc featuring the Daleks. The Doctor made the Beatles appear as a demonstration of the functioning of the visualizer machine. The machine was able to show anything that ever happened in the universe, in the past, in the present, or in the future. Initially, the plan was to show the Beatles made up to look older, but manager Brian Epstein objected, and a clip from Top of the Pops was used instead. The Doctor Who episode was aired on BBC One on the 22nd of May 1965, between 5:40 and 6:05 p.m. In 1967, Paul McCartney and Beatles assistant Mal Evans went shopping in Los Angeles and met John and Michelle Phillips of the Mamas and the Papas in the afternoon. In the evening, Paul left alone and showed up at a Beach Boys session for vegetables. He was recorded chewing celery. He returned at the Phillips' house by midnight. And finally, the 10th of April 1970. In the afternoon, George Harrison gave what was the last interview any Beatle gave while still being a member of the band, for BBC's Fact or Fantasy, talking about his religious beliefs and meditation. The interview was aired on the 26th of April on BBC One, between 6:15 and 6:50 p.m. By that time, though, the Beatles were no more. We have already seen in the last episode of What a Fab Day that the four pages of questions and answers included in Paul's first album, McCartney, might have been interpreted as Paul announcing that he was leaving the band. While this, or the demise of the band, was not announced directly, and despite Apple's denials the day before, this was too much a good headline not to be printed. Daily Mirror's Don Short was the first to write an article about it today, but soon, all around the world, the breakup of the Beatles made the front page and was the first event to be mentioned in any radio or TV news bulletin. It was a bitter surprise for many of the fans, who had remained unaware of the tensions within the band. Ringo's walking out in August 1968, covered in episode 234 of What a Fab Day, had been kept a secret. George's leaving in January 1969, episode 10, had been considered a momentary disagreement of no real consequence, and nobody knew about John's announcement of his departure in September 1969, episode 263, apart from the band's closest circle of friends, due to the contract negotiations with EMI and Capitol. And so, suddenly, the dream was over. If anything, it looked like the breakup was Paul's idea, while in fact it had been a long train a-coming. Contractual engagements, legal squabbling, and the horrible financial situation of Apple forced the four to drag on the Beatles' corpse until 1975, but it was today that the band ceased to exist for the world. Sieged by journalists, Apple press officer Derek Taylor issued one final press release about the band, one of those statements that don't actually say anything. Years later, Taylor said he chose to do so, hoping that the clamor surrounding the news could be subsided and that somehow the four could get back together after a while. But of course, this wasn't the case. Here's the statement. Spring is here and Leeds play Chelsea tomorrow, and Ringo and John and George and Paul are alive and well and full of hope. The world is still spinning, and so are we, and so are you. When the spinning stops, that'll be the time to worry. Not before. Until then, the Beatles are alive and well, and the beat goes on, and the beat goes on. Chelsea and Leeds United play their FA Cup final on the 11th of April. The game ended in a draw, 2-2, making it the first final needing a replay since 1912. This concludes today's episode. Tomorrow will be much more cheerful. In the meantime, let me thank you for following me this far. If you like my work and are wondering if you could do something to ease the burden, please visit www.simonmas.com/support to find ways in which you can help, even for free. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.